those who are guilty get punished for it, right? Now, one of the most important things, one of the most important things in this development of criminal law is that there's, what you can say, the golden thread of criminal law is that the burden of proof is always on this prosecution. That it is always the presumption that a person is innocent when a criminal trial begins. Unfortunately, the problem is happening that I'm seeing increasingly that this golden thread, which actually ought to be held on to in at any cost, is frankly speaking being ignored. Increasingly, it seems that the burden is not really on the prosecution anymore. The burden is shifting to accused persons to prove themselves innocent. The problem with that is that if we indeed, I can see a little bit of a chat things that like voice is not clear. Please sorry about any disruption because obviously happens. Could I request some Mohit and a couple of others to mute themselves, please? I think that's where the noise is coming from. Yeah, I think that's a better idea. With the host could mute all the others. I think I'm being muted as well. I think that should be better. Just give me an indication if you can still hear me. Okay. I'll continue then. Now, the thing is that the problem with having this approach, which is increasingly what we are finding with courts, is that burden is being placed on accused to clear their sense, to prove themselves innocent rather than the other way around, is that it is a major shift in our criminal law. It is based on some fundamental rules of logic that it is extremely difficult to prove a negative. You get what I'm saying? It has always been case of evidence and the case of, it's been a rule of law, rule of criminal trial, that the one making an allegation has to prove the allegation, right? Because that's the essential logic behind it, that it is very difficult for me to prove that something is not the case, that I am innocent, that what they are saying is not true. It's easier for anyone to prove that, okay, yes, this is the evidence, it shows that this is the case, therefore that is the fact of the matter. What we're finding is there's a tendency moving towards shifting the burden to the accused. We started seeing this in one particular area of law. Area of law being crimes against women. Increasingly, it became the fact that a woman's testimony by itself would be sufficient to secure conviction. Now, by itself, it's not a problematic feature of the law. In fact, it's very much required because... some outside noises are coming in. Anyway, I'll try and ignore it. Please do try and ignore some minor noises that come in way. Anyway, so getting back to what I was saying, although by itself, that's not a bad feature. It's necessary that in crimes against women, we do focus on the victim's testimony to be the main evidence. That by itself, I don't have a problem with that. But what it essentially does is that it casts a heavy burden on a person defending a rape accused. Because first of all, you start limiting what kind of things you can challenge the victim's testimony on. Like prior sexual encounters, like the woman's past behavior, things like that. Again, I'm not saying that that's not required, but what it becomes very tempting for lawmakers and for the courts in general to start making that burden tougher on accused, regardless of the crime. And essentially, I find that this is increasingly the case. Today, it's not just in crimes against women that we find that accused are given a very heavy burden. We are finding right now that there are multiple cases in which the burden is being shifted to that of the accused. And overall, I think there's another major area in which the courts are increasingly leaning towards the side of the prosecution is in the regard realm of bail, anticipatory bail and regular bail. I find that the approach of the court is increasingly prosecution friendly. Now, the problem with that is that the classical rule of bail was that bail is the rule, jail is the exception. Because the prize feature of a democracy has been liberty. Liberty has been foremost, that the personal freedom of a person, of any citizen, shall not be compromised. That has been the constant approach of our lawmakers and of our courts, that at no cost should an individual's freedom be compromised. And bail is a very important aspect of that because of the fact that if a person is accused of a crime, he must have some means to secure his freedom while he is still accused of the crime. Till the allegations against him are proved, he must remain free. He should not have his liberty curtailed merely by the fact that there's an allegation against him. But what are we finding today in practice? In practice, what we are finding today is that increasingly courts are becoming tougher on granting bail. Now, there are obviously not just one side of this argument. There is multiple sides of the argument in that regard. There are many who think that that is a correct approach, that it's unsafe to let accused persons back onto the street who are guilty of perhaps violent crimes and things like that. What is has the tendency of doing is that it has the tendency of demonizing such people. Now, this is extremely problematic. The thing is, presumption of innocence goes hand in hand with this concept of liberty. Now, a person in jail, if even if he's under trial, there's a certain demonization that comes with it. That, he's in jail, he must have done something to deserve it. And that is extremely problematic. It's problematic to assume that just simply because a person's in jail, he must have done something to deserve it. But that is the assumption that is made. You cannot prevent against that. And such a thing can be disastrous for somebody. Now, let's say a person who is poor, especially, I'm going to focus on especially the economically weaker section of our society, because they are the ones who are most vulnerable at this, Because we often find that the people with the economically weaker sections of society are the ones who are at greater risk of suffering the ill effects of some of these things that we are listing out today. Because poor people, they can't afford the best legal defense. Therefore, it becomes more difficult for them to obtain bail, first of all, to gain a proper trial, proper defense in their favor. And at the end of the day, we find that overwhelmingly the under trials of our country who are in jail are those from the economically weaker sections of society. Now, that is devastating, not just to the accused person himself, but also to the family of the accused. Because what we find is that such people are lodged in jail, their families get deprived of a breadwinner for simply nothing else but a approach, which I believe is flawed to begin with. The thing is, we must strike a balance somewhere. It should not be that, okay, you're either on bail or you're in jail. You know, can there not be some sort of a halfway point where even though a person is in jail, he is perhaps kept under surveillance, he is perhaps monitored a bit more closely. That can easily be the case. A bail condition can include such details as well. Why must we curtail a person's liberty? Why must we keep him in jail? Jail is devastating. It's not a easy place for the family to be and for the accused to be. Conditions in Indian prisons are terrible because of overcrowding, because of lack of resources. We find that an Indian jail is one of the worst places you can be. So we must avoid this. That is my perspective. But then again, this is the way it is. This is the way it is today. Today, if we are to practice in criminal law, we have to accept the fact that the courts are favoring prosecution in this regard. You know, they're favoring the prosecution side by denying more bails, by pushing the burden further on the defense and making the defense lawyers have to work harder to get results for their clients. Now, what do we as defense lawyers do in such a situation? In such a situation, we as defense lawyers must work much, much harder. It has to be we have to put in much more effort to any given case than we ever did before. Because you know that today the court will not favor you. The court will not be inclined to listen to you. So you have to work that much harder. You have to put in that much more effort to push your case through. It is going to be more difficult for you to make your case, but this is what you must do. You must put in the extra mile of effort in order to get the results. Because the court is going to scrutinize each and every aspect of your application, of your petitions, to find any which way to deny you your prayers. That's when you have to work much harder. You have to put in the extra mile to get the desired result. If that means you have to examine the case forensically, look through each and every sentence of the complaint letters and the charge sheets and the evidence to find exactly what you need, you must do it. Because there cannot be any working on autopilot. You cannot simply push through an old tired argument. You have to put in extraordinary amounts of effort to get the desired results. This is a daunting thing, obviously. It's extremely difficult, especially when you're dealing with a lot of cases, to put in that kind of effort on each and every case. I understand that. But without that, it's not possible to get any results. Thing is that we have to work harder. We have to try harder. It cannot be simply to work on the old arguments that we find a typical bail argument to be a small discussion on merits, small discussion on what is going to be the effect of a person being on bail, and some technical arguments on whether the case holds up to scrutiny or not. We find typically these days bail argument for anticipatory bail takes not much time. Mostly on average, what I find is that an anticipatory bail or argument from the both here after hearing both prosecution and defense and prosecution, it wraps up within half an hour at max if it's a major matter. In smaller cases, in less severe cases, arguments on both prosecution and defense could get away within 10 minutes. It comes down to that short. It's the fact that we don't have the courts hearing these matters for a very long time. They're first of all not giving that much importance to these matters. And second of all, since there's so many of them, they're giving less of a opportunity to defense lawyers to put forward their case. They'll try to cut them short. The lawyers have to push back in such an instance. You have to push through that. No, I must have my case heard. I must have the best hearing. That I must cover these aspects of my case, because without it, it cannot be adjudicated properly. It's difficult. It's definitely extremely difficult. One has to think very strategically of which court to approach first, which is the best forum to first apply in, whether to first have a rejection by the Sessions Court, then go before the High Court, and things like that. It's a tough thing to work out. It's not easy. It's definitely not an easy ride. And we must be prepared for that. You must also prepare your clients for that. The problem is that litigants are not very very easy to deal with. You must make your clients understand that. You must explain to them that, okay, be realistic is what your expectations of the case will be. Be realistic with your clients and be realistic with them in the sense that you tell them. And of course, in this kind of a case, you are most probably not going to get bail for the first month or so. That maybe it might be even 2 months or 2.5 months in getting bail. But we must be prepared for that eventually. If you are forward with your clients, if you go and set their expectations in a proper sense, they will be better prepared for the outcomes that come about. It's important for practitioners to be realistic with their chances. Of course, I do believe the courts should re-examine their approach. I do not think it's a correct approach to the practice to have a rigid nature will not grant bail. The number of years which are the maximum sentence, I shall pass an order of rejection of bail. That is not the correct approach. It is especially true in the lower courts that judges look at the offense, look at the maximum number of years that are prescribed for punishment, and accordingly decide whether I'm going to allow this bail petition or reject this bail petition. That's a horrible approach. It's a horrendous approach. That should never be what goes through a judge's mind. That, okay, this is a very severe offense. It is very severe penalties. Therefore, I am not going to allow you. That should not be the case. But it unfortunately is the case. That is what's happening today. There are judges who are coming into court with that mindset. You can have to deal with it. I undoubtedly think that's a wrong approach. But that's the approach. That is what's happening in a lot of cases. We should push back against this tendency. As a defense lawyer, when we enter the courtroom with somebody accused of a heinous offense, the first thing you ought to say is that, yes, I know my lord or your honor that this case is of that of a very severe offense, that there are severe penalties of this for this offense. But does that mean that my client should not get bail? No. That does not mean that my client should not be granted bail. The merits of each case are different. The merits of each and every bail petition is different. And that is what you should impress upon the judge. That you cannot have a one-size-fits-all approach. That there should never be a rigid formula as to what cases should be granted bail. That is my sincere belief, that you cannot have a one-size-fits-all approach. But coming back to what a defense lawyer ought to do, as I said, the work that one must put in has to be of the highest quality. Re-examine the laws at every step. Keep yourself updated with the latest judgments. Keep yourself updated with the latest trends in the criminal jurisprudence. That is something you must do. You must at all times have the latest information on your fingertips. You must have at hand the developments of the crime in question. If you're a client has been accused of murder, you must have the latest judgments of murder ready at hand to examine, at dissect as to what you can use, what you can't, what arguments can work, what arguments have been accepted by the Supreme Court, what are the aspects that you must, that prosecution has to prove. These are the things you must consider. But another thing I would like to I am digressing a bit here, but one of the main things that annoys me about a lot of junior criminal lawyers and the approach of some of them is that in regards to discharge of accused, there is a great misconception behind that a lot of junior criminal lawyers seem to be laboring under. It is a very basic aspect of the law, discharge. When I say discharge, what do I mean? At what is the thing that you should focus on? A lot of lawyers make the mistake, I find it even today, that they go into arguments on merits in discharge. They go into what their client has told them and use that to make an argument on discharge. It is not supposed to be that exhaustive. You're not supposed to go into the nitty-gritties of the case when you're dealing with a discharge case. When you're arguing for discharge of an accused, you are merely looking at the prima facie basis. Why have the courts started leaning towards prosecution side? Frankly speaking, I blame the media a lot here. It's a very good question. I blame the media a lot here. The media is to blame in the sense that, you know, increasingly it's become a tendency that when an accused is granted bail, the question that is put forth by the news media is, why has this person been granted bail? Why should this person have been granted bail? Such granting of bail is a disservice to justice. It subserves the process of justice. And all these things that they bring up. This is going to play on judges' minds. When the media questions judges' decisions, it is bound to play some effect on the mind of the judges. They are bound to start examining, okay, should we grant bail in this case? Will it not receive a backlash from the media? Now, I don't think this case should be granted bail, because then I will be questioned by public that why should you grant this person on bail? This is a problematic thing. Another reason I think this has started happening is that increasingly it has become the tendency of judges to see that If a person on bail commits another crime, fingers will be raised asking why was this person granted bail to begin with. Another question has been asked that can we say courts are biased so far as prosecution is considered in general? I wouldn't say biased, because bias would involve courts blindly favoring one side. But the courts do not blindly favor the prosecution. The courts do examine the prosecution's story. They do examine the defense's story quite heavily. And yes, although there is some tendency to lean in favor of prosecution, that does not mean the prosecution gets a free pass. In fact, the courts are actually quite harsh upon the prosecution if they don't do their job properly. If the prosecution does not do their job properly, the courts are very quick to come down quite harshly on them. But Yes, if you'd say at the beginning of the case, what would be the leaning of the judge in most courts? Most courts, most judges would be favoring slightly towards the prosecution. That's another question. That's how far does public pressure go in impacting the courts adopting a favorable approach towards prosecution? I would say it's definitely a huge impact. Public pressure, public interest is one of the main reasons that the courts lean towards prosecution in the first place. That when there is a case where there is much media coverage, where there is much media interest, there is definitely a tendency of the court favoring the prosecution. The court will definitely take the proactive approach towards prosecution of the accused. Like, would you say courts in certain so-called sensational matters respond quicker and often? Definitely. In terms of sensational matters, the matters which are in the media eye, which are in the coverage of the media, the courts will definitely take up a more proactive leaning towards prosecution. And that is a huge problem. That, according to me, is a huge problem. Because just because there is media interest doesn't mean that the court should favor a prosecution in such instances. They might be outraged, they might be huge public pressure, but the court ought to stay clear of that. But that is a very idealistic scenario. We cannot expect the courts to, we cannot expect judges to be saints who are perfect. We cannot expect that. Judges are, after all, part of society. They live in society. Then that's how it works. Someone asks, if in case where accused is a habitual offender, then still there is a presumption of innocence towards accused? There should be. There should be. That is the ideal golden thread of criminal jurisprudence, as I was saying at the beginning of my talk. That even if a person has committed several crimes in his past, there is no reason to assume that this allegation against him is a true allegation. We should still maintain the... In fact, if you look at it very frankly, I'd say the majority of rape cases aren't really covered by the media very much. And one of the things you have to remember is the courts are in fact burdened with trials. Courts are today a little behind the times in the sense that we are not adopting enough technology. Like, video conferencing for matters has only been adopted owing to the pandemic. It's something that should have been done ages ago, and only in a few select cases where it's actually used prior to this. That is one of the new things, that trials are taking too long to complete in India. Like, an average trial in an ordinary criminal case, you can easily expect to stretch on for about 10 years. That's an insane amount of time for a criminal trial. And what happens in such an instance is, especially with criminal cases, is that many times the witnesses don't show up after a few years. They can't be traced. The prosecution cannot manage to put its case together. They seek adjournments. They can't bring the witnesses forward. It carries on. So that is just one of the things that matters. So how far is the intensity of courts being in favor of the prosecution so far as domestic violence matters are concerned? With regard to domestic violence, actually, courts were very in favor of the prosecution in that regard. If you look at it, one of the most iconic judgments in recent years was Anish Kumar versus the state of Bihar. Anish Kumar was revolutionary in many sense, because in Anish Kumar, the Supreme Court recognized that there was being a tendency to favor the prosecution, that bail wasn't being granted in routine matters. And to prevent such misuse of law, to prevent prosecution excess, the Anish Kumar judgment laid down the guidelines that there must be a 41A notice to the accused in every case where there is an imprisonment of less than 7 years. With in every instance, every case where the maximum punishment is less up to or less than 7 years imprisonment, 41A notice was made compulsory. Now, what happened with 41A notice? With 41A notice, the accused would have to come to the police station, would present their side of the story, and the courts would take a proactive approach and would say that, yes, he's attended 41A notice, he's complied with the requirements, therefore, he's not absconding, grant bail. That was revolutionary. But 41A notice by itself, it's not a requirement. But even if you attend 41A, if you comply with the summon sent under 41A, even then you are likely to have your bail rejected if the case allegations are of that nature, of such nature. Even, for instance, cheating cases. Now, this is one of the main issues I have with regard to cheating cases, economic offenses. Is there any reason why an accused has to be behind bars for so long? Achha, sorry, I think my video got interrupted. I'm sorry. Is there any reason why an economic offense accused has to remain in jail for a period of 2-3 years while trial is not yet started? That is insane. I do not think it makes any sense for an economic offense accused to be behind bars for so long. You have a simple measure to ensure that he cannot cash in his proceeds and run. Freeze his bank accounts. Seize his assets. Take adequate security from him. But why should the person be behind bars for so long? It's an economic offense. What sense does it make? I do not understand. Yes, there are some arguments that are made that, yeah, he might run away like Vijay Mallya and all. But of course, most fraudsters aren't resourceful like Vijay Mallya. They will not be able to escape the system like that. Yes, you may say one Vijay Mallya makes it bad for everybody else. But then again, as I keep saying, you cannot approach a one-size-fits-all approach. This is people's lives you're dealing with. You cannot say that, okay, one person messed up, therefore all of you should suffer. That cannot be the approach. I personally definitely think that there's something very bad. Fundamental rights of accused is curtailed, although his offense is not proved. Even under bail, the rights of the accused is restricted. And many times the accused, for 10, 15 years, the rights of the accused just was curtailed. True, definitely. I agree with you there. Because what we find is that the person is undergoing trial for an offense for years on end. He's suffering the demonization of being under trial, lodged in prison for so many years. Even if he's found innocent at the end of it all, at what cost? The cost, human cost of it is severe. Now, coming to defense lawyers again, the point I was making on defense lawyers. There is a tendency amongst law students these days, many law students of like elite law colleges and stuff, that they graduate and the first thing they do is join a lawyer in the high court, start practicing in the high court or the Supreme Court directly. Terrible. This is a terrible thing for a defense lawyer to do. If you're going to practice criminal law, one of the main things you ought to do is have an idea of how criminal trial works. You cannot straight away go to the appellate or the divisional stage and expect that without having any experience in trial court to work wonders there. The appellate or the divisional stage is not complete without having knowledge of how trial works. It's very important for a defense lawyer to know what trial is. Criminal lawyers in general, I'm not saying prosecution or defense, you need to know how trial works, how the trial court works. You need to have an experience in criminal trial, because the rules of criminal trial, the methodology of criminal trial, what is undergone in a criminal trial ought to be known by you. I think one of the main problems has been that many lawyers who are practicing in the High Court and Supreme Court have not had an experience with the trial. They've not seen what conditions the trial courts are like. They do not know what a trial comprises of. And why is that a problem? I'll tell you. The problem is that these lawyers who practice in the High Court or Supreme Court are the ones who are more likely to be appointed as judges. And if they are the ones being appointed as judges of the High Court and the Supreme Court, they do not know what trial courts are going through. They do not understand what are the problems being faced by trial lawyers. And what happens as a result is they adopt these approaches to criminal matters without knowing what they're basing their judgment on. They're not knowing what effect it's having on those who are practicing at the lowest level. When the Supreme Court has clearly observed that mere severity of the crime cannot be ground to deny bail, why do you think subordinate courts continue to deny bail only on this ground? Why the courts do not see the circumstances or other factors which they will be considering eventually at the time of probation in case of conviction, at time of granting bail also? The problem is that, yes, the Supreme Court has observed this. But I think one of the major problems is that sometimes it seems we do not get consistent signals from the Supreme Court in this regard. On the one hand, Supreme Court has observed that the severity of the offense and the kind of allegations against the accused ought not to be considered when granting or denying bail. But when it comes to practice, when accused go before the Supreme Court for such cases, a lot of the times bails are rejected on exactly that ground. Now, in light of these contrary approaches to the Supreme Court, in light of these contradictory signals given by the Supreme Court, what is the trial court judges or the High Court judges more likely to do? They are more likely to err on the side of caution. They are not going to be the judge who release the person on bail. They are not going to even risk the fact that they might be accused of partiality or bias or being sold out. They are not going to risk that allegation. That is one of the major problems. But another side is that what message will go to the society? Commit offense and get bail. Then after a few years, get acquitted due to lacunas of prosecution case. Now in all, who will suffer? Only victim. Will all these lead to justice to the victim? Very good question. Very, very good question, because this is primarily the factor that plays in the mind of the judges. They think, okay, what is going to be the public perception of justice, of the justice system? What is going to be the effect on the public if such persons are released on bail? That is a very valid point, a very valid consideration. But then again, there must be a balance struck. It cannot be that to send a message to society, we demonize one set of people. We cannot demonize every accused person simply because of societal perception. And as I said, bail conditions can be made harsh. The judges have the power. Judges have the power to set very harsh bail conditions to ensure that such people do not misuse their liberty given to them. But does that mean we must ignore liberty? We must deny liberty to accused? I do not think so. Now, with regard to justice being given done to the victim, I think the way we can do justice to both the victim and the accused is to ensure speedy trial. The reason there is a lot of injustice in the system today boils down to one factor and one factor alone. That one factor is the delays that are caused in our judiciary, the delays that are caused in holding of trial. If we can ensure speedy trial, we will ensure that we do justice, not just for those who have been suffering at the hands of suffering from crime, those who have been victims of crime, but we also ensure justice for those who have been wrongly accused of crime. Because nothing is worse for a person who has been falsely accused than to suffer a long trial where by the time his name is cleared, it might be too late for him. That would be true injustice. So the true way to ensure speedy justice is not to ensure that the courts lean towards the prosecution or are less or more strict with bail. The way to ensure justice is to ensure speedy trial. That should be the focus. That should be the aim. Let us get trials working quickly. Why can't there be day-to-day trial? There should be day-to-day trial. When a case starts in court, we should ensure that all the witnesses are arraigned and the case goes on in a day-to-day basis. There's no reason that a case, I have seen this happen too many occasions. Case heard one day, the next date is given 1 year later. 1 whole year for another date in the matter. That's too long by anybody's standard. Cannot be so. It should not be so. And I feel it can easily be done. We can ensure that trials move faster. I personally think so. And there is no reason why we should not. Sir, is it favorism or the nowadays most of the advocate have not such efficiency to prove prosecution wrong? True. I personally think that is, again, one thing that I have been mentioning here, that we must do better. The defense lawyers ought to put in more effort. I do find that many defense lawyers are working on autopilot. In the sense, okay, this is the case, these are the ingredients of the offense. Let me just ensure that the ingredients match the offense first. That's all I'll do. They go by the same tired old arguments that they've been working on for years. And they present it in every case as if it's a new one. That is not acceptable. We must do better as defense lawyers. We have to put in more effort. When we know that the courts are not favoring us, we have to try harder, we have to work harder. We have to put in more effort than we've ever done before. We have to ensure that we read more, we study more, we prepare more for each case, and we present our best foot forward. It's an important factor, undoubtedly. One of the reasons why judges, again, tend to favor the prosecution is because the defense is that underprepared. The prosecutor has the advantage in that sense that they have the police to assist them. The police are prepared, the police do their job properly, and they're ready with their material. The defense, on the other hand, aren't that well prepared, don't have that much resources, they don't try that hard. That's a problem. That is definitely a problem. Defense lawyers ought to do better. We need to ensure that we are doing the best for our clients. That is one thing we have to do. On corruption in the lower courts, do you suppose this delay and injustice in the system is because of the nexus between prosecutors and judicial clerks? Does this end up reflecting in our poor decision? Has that been your observation of life? I won't deny. There is definitely instances of that. There is definitely corruption in the judicial system, as is there in other systems of our country. But the problem isn't just corruption. The problem isn't just corruption. It's not as simplistic as that. I feel the problem is greater in the sense that we are somehow all responsible for this in some way. Because prosecutors aren't ready with their matters. They aren't prepared with all their witnesses. And another thing is that defense lawyers, they are not ready with their defense. They are not prepared to deal with the case. They need time and effort. They haven't put in the amount of time and effort they require to have their case ready. And that is why it takes a long time. Because both the prosecution and the defense are looking for more time to prepare their case, to prepare their witnesses, to prepare their cross-examination, to ready their defense. It's a problematic thing. Another thing that I wanted to hit upon, which I intended to talk about, is that today it's no longer enough for a defense lawyer in a criminal trial to merely point out the flaws in the prosecution case. Most courts today will expect you to have an alternative version of events. It's not merely enough for you to pick apart the whole prosecution case and point out the holes in it. You have to come up with an alternate theory. You have to come up with an alternative version of events, which is contradicts the case of the prosecution. That is tough work, I must say. That's not an easy thing to do. But that is what the courts expect you today. The courts will expect you to come up with not just problems and flaws with the prosecution dealing of prosecution version of events, but they will also expect you to come up with an alternative theory as to what could have possibly happened. That's something that is very difficult to do. But that's what you have to do today. You have to put in that effort. You have to come up with these things to explain away why your client is not guilty. Question has been asked. So, sir, we can say that our education system for advocates should be improved by BCI to produce good advocates. So, any other solution is there? Look, frankly speaking, I do not think there is much that can be done in terms of the legal education system. Apart from having greater exposure to practical legal training. I personally have always been of the opinion that you cannot teach law in a classroom. You cannot teach law by lectures. You have to give a practical insight as to how it works. You have to be able to see law working in practice for you to properly understand and appreciate what is there. Like all these things I've been telling you, I do not think you will properly appreciate the importance of what I'm telling you unless you see it when you come into practice. Unless you go into the criminal courts and you see this is going on, you will not quite appreciate what is the effect of what I'm saying. Because practical exposure is the only thing. Unless you go out into the field and see it for yourself, you will never properly appreciate the law and the legal jurisprudence of the matter. Legal training has become too formalistic, in my opinion. In legal education, 5 years law course, what is happening is you're giving 60 exams over the course of 10 semesters. At the end of the day, it's not really giving you an exposure to how it works in reality. Your vacations are too short to understand practically how the law works. And reading the law as it is in statutes is never going to substitute actually seeing it work out in practice. Unless you go to court and you see it happen, you will not properly appreciate these lessons. I personally think so. I think I'll wrap up here. I've been jabbering for quite a long time. Let me just go on another thing. Sometimes the situation arises where counsel for accused has presented enough witnesses to prove right the accused and the victim doesn't have sufficient grounds to prove against the accused, but then also somehow judge has idea about the actual wrong with victim, then what approach should be adopted by judiciary? As I said before, you know, that the judges ought to be balanced. The judge ought to be balanced in their approach. They cannot say that one size fits all, as I said. I'll keep repeating this, but it cannot be a one size fits all approach. The judge cannot come into the case with the mindset that, okay, if this happens, I am going to convict or I am going to acquit. The judge needs to be balanced in their approach. The judiciary needs to approach each case as if it's unique in its merits. Even if they've seen 100 such cases, they need to treat each case as if it's unique. That, I think, is one of the most important things the judiciary to work. So, sir, in legal education, there should be more practical works in comparison with theory. I feel that, you know, very frankly, I'm of the opinion that you need to have a practical exposure as far as possible. You know, one of the reasons I rate the Government Law College Bombay very highly, or I used to, but I don't know what the situation is there now. But one of the reasons I used to rate GLC very highly is because graduates from GLC would have, at the end of their time in college, enough exposure in practical legal learning to equip themselves better in legal practice. Because what GLC used to do is GLC Bombay used to have classes till 11 a.m. if I'm not incorrect, and the rest of the time during the day, the students of GLC used to go to courts and law firms to gain practical learning. And I think that's brilliant. That's in fact an approach I think every law college should have. That, you know, finish off your classes early. Let's not have lengthy classes. You don't need 1 hour lectures in every subject. You go over the course material, yes, as minimally as you can, and let the person learn through practical training. I think that would be the best approach. Sir, don't you think even high-end justice deliverer are known of fact, the fact that there are lacunas in law? For example, one of the judges declared not to allow judge job to a specific gender just because he was alleged. But a common man does not have the same option. Why don't they give such strong guidelines on that? I think guidelines are there, but at the end of the day, since they're guidelines, they're not really adopted that universally, if you know what I mean. It's not really seen in that way. I think that's the problem, that a lot of judges are not taking these things seriously. How can we find judgments of lower courts? I don't think you need to find judgments of lower courts. Judgments of lower courts aren't really binding. So no point in going by judgment of lower courts. Shayabda, many young graduates today are not enticed towards practice, let alone trial court practice. Is that just because students feel privileged, or is that anything that our system can do to entice young graduates towards trial courts, a more professional atmosphere perhaps? Very good suggestion. I think that is definitely a problem, that we are not enticing law graduates to join trial court. We are not making it advantageous for them to join the litigation field altogether. I think this is something that wiser heads than mine need to deliberate about. I can merely point out the flaws, but I don't think I am best placed to provide solutions here. I think one of the things that can be done is definitely you should point out to law students the advantage of working in trial courts, and maybe then they will realize that it is a huge advantage and can work towards a better career future later on. And sir, I want to be an advocate, so much time it will, how much time it will take to establish as a good advocate, and I have no word further. Hard to say, boss. Hard to say. It could be